Hey folks, this is Alexander Winn.
Hi, I'm Lacey Hannan.
And we are the co-founders of Edgeworks Entertainment and the creators of the video game TerraGenesis. And we're here with our new show called The Synthesis, where we investigate pop culture like movies and TV shows and video games and how they portray realistic science and realistic history.
And books. He forgot books. We're going to do those too.
Yes.
I like to read, so I can't let you forget that.
We're going to be talking about both the quality of the product, what did we like, what did we not like, and we're also going to be talking about how did it portray events that really happened or realistic scientific principles and integrate them to the story being told.
And now our credentials are mostly that, well, hey, we have a video game company, so we do science here.
Lacey and I both came up in Hollywood, though.
Yes.
We both studied film and acting in different ways, and we've both worked in Hollywood, mm-hmm. and we kind of fell sideways into video games, so this is sort of getting back to our roots.
Yes. So just recognize we will be talking about the acting, the writing, the lighting, the all of it,
yeah.
and the real science, the real history, all that
and
jazz.
How they work together.
Yeah. What's anything else that we need to tell them about?
I think that's it.
No. We're married. You need to know that. I don't know if that is a warning or if that is something that you are going to celebrate alongside us, but just recognize that that is the relationship here. So if it gets awkward or awesome, that'd be why.
That's why. So
yes.
Today we're going to be talking about Apollo 13.
Which I had never seen
which
before.
Which Lacey had never seen before. So with that in mind, would you like to give us a quick back of the box recap?
Well, I will start with this movie is not about the Challenger.
It's true. We've got real facts here.
So get excited because there isn't a teacher on board and it doesn't explode.
It's so worth mentioning, Lacey has a thing about disasters in space.
Don't like them.
So she has always avoided Apollo 13.
I didn't, so
she didn't really know much about it.
I don't really know my space or my NASA history, which I really should learn sometime.
I think you would have picked it up by osmosis at this point.
You'd think. but I really came into this going, man, it's so early in Tom Hanks' career for him to die. Like, this is going to be weird to watch. Have we ever seen that? So anyway, that's not what this movie is. This movie is, what year is it?
The movie came out in 1995.
No. What year does Apollo 13 take off?
I don't know.
Okay. Well,
off
it's
to a
then.
Good start.
We're doing great. So anyway, it's based on a true story about Apollo 13. They were supposed to do the second
third moon.
Well, okay. But as we know, only one group did it. So anyway, they were supposed to do that. Didn't work out so well. Everything went wrong. Like everything.
That's the log line. Everything went wrong. Apollo 13. Everything went wrong.
But anyway, I don't really think you have to know much more about it. I mean, you should probably watch it.
It's pretty good.
I can actually tell you that it's worth watching.
Despite it being about a space disaster.
Yes.
All right. So some quick facts. Released in 1995, directed by Ron Howard, written by Bill Broyles and Al Reinert, and based on a book written partially by Jim Lovell. So this was semi-autobiographical.
An incredible cast.
Incredible cast. We've got Tom Hanks, Ed Harris, Bill Paxton, Kevin Bacon, Gary Sinise, and Kathleen Quinlan. And they're all awesome. It was nominated for a whole bunch of Academy Awards. I think it won two of them. It won Best Editing and Best Sound Design. But there was some acting. It was up for Best Picture, lost out to Braveheart. And budget of $52 million and made $355 million. So definitely
they did all
success.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One interesting thing before we get into it that I read as I was doing some research is apparently it was written with Kevin Costner in mind for the Tom Hanks role. Apparently because he physically resembles Jim Lovell so much.
And do we know why that switch happened?
I don't know why he didn't get it, but apparently the studio was more interested in somebody else. And there's a quote that I found that I couldn't find any more information on, but I was so intrigued, which is, ultimately, Hanks was cast instead in that role because of his knowledge of Apollo and space history.
So he's a nerd, too.
So apparently, I knew he was a huge World War II nerd, but apparently he might also be a space nerd, and apparently it might have gotten him the role, which is just so charming.
Well, he's charming, so that makes sense.
Yes. Also worth mentioning, Gary Sinise was invited by Ron Howard to read for any of the characters he wanted, and he picked the character of Mattingly. So
he did a
awesome job.
Excellent job. All right, shall we start?
So so first off, what did you think overall? Before we start getting into the nitty gritty, like I had seen this movie several times and I knew what I was getting into. What's your
I had a whole
top sheet takeaway?
I had a whole journey of around this movie. So yep. Do you want the final thought, or like do you want the little journey?
The overall thought. What's the general thumbs up, thumbs down?
Definite thumbs up.
Yeah.
I actually give it 2 thumbs up for the entirety of the movie, mm-hmm. and I give it a 1 thumb sideways for the first 30 minutes.
All right.
Which I found real boring.
Well, then let's talk about the first 30 minutes.
Okay. Okay. So one of the first things you see is they go through, what was it? Apollo, which one? Apollo 1 that everybody burned alive, which is horrifying.
Yeah, that's actually the first note that I had too, which was interesting that they're starting with stuff goes wrong at NASA sometimes is literally the first beat of the film.
And one of the first images you see is like this inverse Titanic shot where instead of like this beautiful sex scene handprint on a condensed window, no. It is an astronaut's glove inside of the shuttle, and there is fire behind them, and they can't get out. And it is horrifying. I was like, what is this? What are we getting into? Why?
So
at that point, I knew I'd cry at some point.
Yep. So for those of you who don't know, interesting little history tidbit. Apollo 1, the astronauts actually died in the training simulator. It wasn't even in the thing. They were simulating the flight, and the console caught fire. And Apollo 1 was back in the day when NASA was experimenting with using pure oxygen environments. And
because
the thought was, humans can survive perfectly well. Earth's air is 21% oxygen. And the rest is basically just filler. It's nitrogen, which does nothing. And so NASA was experimenting with the idea of instead of having full pressure with 21% oxygen, you could have 21% pressure, 100% oxygen. And it's just as good for the human body. But when that happened, when Apollo 1 happened, that fire spread so quickly in an all-oxygen environment that they didn't have time to react, and all of the astronauts died. And that's why NASA stopped doing all-oxygen environments.
So wait, did Apollo 13 lie to us? Or did the movie lie to us? Because I was under the impression that the astronauts died right before like liftoff. They were on the launch pad.
It didn't lie. It was just kind of ambiguous. They don't.
Jerks.
It's the whole thing is under like music and voiceover, and it just shows a bunch of astronauts in a capsule pressing buttons and then a fire, and so they don't sort of comment one way or another whether it was an actual flight or a simulator flight. It was a simulator flight.
Well, I feel like they lied to me, and I feel like Tom Hanks lied to his son later in the movie. We will get to that, because now I have feelings about it. Okay, so, I mean, the two things that I got right off the bat mm-hmm. Is that Tom Hanks is a terrible driver. he does it multiple times, and for someone who's supposed to be able to pilot really well, He drives like a jerk.
Astronauts are kind of famous for, you know.
But Tom Hanks does not play the arrogant astronaut in this movie whatsoever. But the also Kevin Bacon has the least subtle like sexual innuendo joke I have ever heard. Like it wasn't even innuendo.
No.
It was just like
It was just an illustration. Yeah. It was like, here's a diagram of what I want to do later tonight.
Oh, it was, there was so much like mail seeping off the screen.
That being said, I do think that the very beginning, those first few scenes, they did a really good job of setting up the yearning, of establishing just how much these guys want to go to space. And they really kind of established the stakes of going to the moon for these guys. This isn't some intellectual exercise or even a matter of patriotism. This is like their life's dream.
Mm-hmm.
And you got that within a couple of minutes, which was awesome.
It is always awesome seeing people be passionate about something.
Right.
And like even in that sexual reference, like, or illustration, whatever you want to call it, like, he's obviously incredibly intelligent and incredibly passionate. Mm-hmm. And yes, he wants to have sex with this woman, but he's using space to illustrate that.
Yeah, exactly.
I
like, it's
know.
Kind of telling that he's not just giving her
a pickup line
from a bar.
Yeah.
He's describing a docking procedure.
It's so dorky. But, like, I mean, you guys, in any, like, anything we watch, this is going to be true for me. I love watching people be really passionate about things, even if it's incredibly nerdy and dorky, which is a big reason I think I got married to you. Love me those nerds. Okay.
I will say before we move on from this, because it happened in the same scene, I did not remember. There's a certain line when Lovell and his wife are sitting in the backyard and looking up at the moon. There's a line that he says which just sort of captured my heart, because I feel like it's sort of the mission statement not only of Apollo 13 but of the entire space race and even TerraGenesis and even Edgeworks is sort of our tagline. He's talking about landing on the moon. He's talking about Neil Armstrong. He's up there right now. They're looking up at the moon. And he says, it's not a miracle. We just decided to go.
Yeah.
And that is such a perfect line for science. Like, it's not some magical thing. We just decided to do it.
I wrote it down, too. So the full quote is, from now on, we live in a world where we've gone to the moon. It's not a miracle. We just decided to go.
Yeah.
And I just, I loved it. It was
so
really
good.
Powerful to me, because I feel like that is always how innovation works.
Yes.
Innovation is rarely accidental. I mean, obviously, science can have big accidents, but so much of what even takes to get to those accidents, there's so much purpose behind it. And so I thought it was really beautiful. I thought that was an incredible line.
It's also sort of a commentary on what you're about to see in Apollo 13, because the whole point of this movie is solving problems. And at no point in this movie do they just kind of throw up their hands and say, we'll see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
They are always coming back to this sort of focused, determine, work the problem, figure out how we're going to do this, make your own luck. It's really sort of the mantra of NASA throughout the entire film.
One of the other things that I liked from the beginning of this was, okay, first of all, footage of us walking on the moon will never get old for me.
Yeah.
It will always make me tear up. Like, I'm choking up right now. I will always love it.
Yeah.
But the other thing that I really liked, you know, we understand that the wives of these astronauts and the families go through so much. You think of it with military families, like, all of the people who are at home are having, like, nervous breakdowns, or they're, you know, worried all the time, or
really
whatever.
Stressful.
And how I love how they expressed hers. It wasn't cliched at all. She says something along the lines of, I just vacuumed over and over again.
Yeah.
And I was like, it's funny, but you can totally see it as, like,
she needed to do something.
Yeah. And I thought it was just a real clever way of showing her character. They did a great job.
Nominated for Best Supporting Actress, by the way.
Well, she did a great job.
Yes.
Those redheads, they're great.
She did a great job, and worth mentioning, she did a great job in a role that you sort of didn't have to do a great job in.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that with a lesser actress, that could have just been hand-wringing for 2 hours, but she really had some great moments, even in scenes where she's just sitting on the floor, she's conveying a lot.
Yeah. So then we kind of move into this area where he's giving a tour to politicians and mm-hmm. whatever. And really the only thing that I have to say about this scene is those damn politicians.
Yeah.
They're such jerks. He says something about, you know, Tom Hanks's character, Lovell. Is that what his name is?
Yeah.
He is supposed to be on Apollo 14. He's not even supposed to be on this mission. Mm-hmm. And this politician says, if there is an Apollo 14. And I was like, dude, this is his dream. Keep your mouth shut. Why are you a jackass? I was so floored that anybody would be like, I'm going to try and wreck your dreams.
Fun fact, by the way, that politician is played by horror director Roger Corman, who was something of a mentor to Ron Howard and all throughout the film industry. And he sort of had kind of an Alfred Hitchcock thing where he would show up in cameos in various movies.
Really?
Yeah. So Roger Corman, have you ever seen a Roger Corman film? He's that jerk politician from Apollo 13.
Fascinating and weird.
Yeah.
I don't know horror, so.
We do, I found myself absolutely marveling at the simulator that they use, because it's all analog. And obviously this is, you know, the early 70s. It's not, they would not have digital simulations or anything like that, but I just, as somebody who has spent a lot of hours designing simulations of space, I was watching them like carefully moving joysticks, and then it cuts to this tiny little lipstick camera moving toward a wooden model. And it just blew my mind. You know, people talk all the time about the fact that we landed on the moon with, you know, computers that had less processing power than a graphing calculator. And it just kind of it reminded me of that you're sitting in this incredibly sophisticated system that's got, like, wooden models.
He says at one point during the tour, computers that fit in one room, and we both kind of giggled because, like, it's just so far removed from our reality.
Exactly.
So, yeah.
So I've got a question for you. Mm. I would go to your launch. Would you come to my launch?
I would go to your launch. Now listen.
It gets better because his wife does in fact go to the launch, but there's a scene in their car where she talks about not wanting to go to his launch, and it's so heartbreaking because you see his face fall, and it's just, oh.
Now, see, here's the deal. I totally understand her, and, you know, apparently she is one of the few that goes to, mm-hmm. has gone to all of the launches, mm-hmm. and I get it. Yep. There would be so much anxiety that I don't know. Yeah. I get it, mm-hmm. but that's the one where he was supposed to go to the moon, so.
Yeah, exactly. You gotta be there.
You gotta be there, yeah. Yeah, I would go.
There is another, in the world of sort of background research, a funny thing that I learned. There's a particularly memorable scene where all the astronauts are standing on one side of a street and all of their families are standing on the mm-hmm. other side of the street because they don't want to get them sick. And apparently that is a NASA tradition, but it started after Apollo 13. So that's a little bit of an anachronism.
Oh, interesting.
It started with the space shuttle era. So, yeah, it's just a little throwback.
I do have to say I was getting a little annoyed that they hit 13 over and over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
So everyone's commenting on how it's Apollo 13, why they have to name it Apollo 13, and I think he even says because it comes after 12.
Yeah,
which was a funny line, but for whatever reason, it really felt like in a lot of ways they weren't giving away the story. Except for in the writing, but not in the lighting of it, not in the sound design of it, not in the editing of it. There were lots of things that were going, okay, maybe this movie's not going to just be terrifying and trouble and mm-hmm. sad.
Yeah, I think they were definitely expecting that most people in the audience knew where this was going, at least a little bit.
Listen, I don't like disaster movies, and I don't like disaster in space movies. So next time I will go to Wikipedia and find out what things are about. I've only done this once before, and I actually vowed I would never do it again. I don't know why I went into this blind. Because nobody would have expected me to be blind. That's right.
I do have a little bit of good news for you.
Okay.
Which is there's a scene early in the film where there's a nightmare where he gets sucked out into space.
His wife's nightmare.
His wife has that. Yeah. There's also a scene where she loses her wedding ring in the shower. Good news, both of those happened, but she got her ring back. She was able to fish the ring out of the drain just a little bit.
Now, okay.
A little bit of good news.
I think they should have added that.
Yeah.
Because that would have actually set up what happens. Because when he says
to
her,
she almost loses him, but doesn't.
Because he says to her, "You can't live without me." And then she goes back to the hotel and loses her wedding ring. And I'm sitting here going, "Oh no, he's gonna die." they're gonna kill off Tom Hanks. And then she's not gonna have like the wedding ring, the symbol that most people want to have and keep forever if their spouse dies. Yep. Like, oh, this is horrifying. Mm. So her having gotten it back would have maybe put me at ease just a little
bit. Fair enough. Then again, putting you at ease was not their goal.
But they weren't trying to terrify me like, say, Gravity or some of the other movies, like space disaster movies. So they could have. I think so, too. Yeah. Damn you, Ron Howard.
So do you have anything else before the launch?
Let's see here. Oh, yes, I do. I do. I thought Hanks made some really great points about switching out the crew. Mm. I decided in watching all of this that I really want more team movies. Mm. I loved this not because there was one genius and he was the only person who could pull it off. No, no, no. I love that everybody in the room knows what they're doing and it's redundant.
Yeah.
And I like there's something
competence porn in teams.
Yes.
It's that same West Wing kind of thing. Like really everything Aaron Sorkin writes, but yeah.
Yes. And so, like, for me, when he said, you know, we know each other's voices. We know like, every little inflection.
Read each other's body language.
And I'm sitting here going, he's right.
And then they do a really good job of setting up. As soon as Kevin Bacon's in the chair, it feels awkward.
Yeah.
That, like, it does not feel like they're in sync.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So there was that part. And then the other thing was when they have like the stressful moments, mm-hmm. their calm voices that everyone does, which they use proficiently throughout this movie, the calm voices are both terrifying and incredible.
Mm-hmm.
Like there's the amount of training you would have to be able to manage your stress so well. To be able to keep your voice at that level at all times and no matter what's happening. I don't know.
Professionalism.
I was blown away. And it kind of freaked me out.
Yeah.
So that's what I have to say before the launch. Before the launch, yeah.
All right. So half an hour into the movie, the rocket takes off and we are officially starting the story of Apollo 13. As Lacey and I were watching it, the Apple TV freezes at that point and has to buffer. And Lacey, who thought that this was a movie about the Challenger disaster, looks at the timeline and goes, wait, how are we only this far into the movie?
I also didn't understand how everyone could think this movie was incredible at this point because it was so slow.
Yeah.
And so I was having issues and I had maybe a little bit of an outburst. I'm sorry that you won't be seeing it today. That's too bad.
So they get into space, and one of the things that I remember the best about this entire film is the zero-G sequences. Mm. This is by far the best zero-G stuff from any movie ever, and it's because they did it for real. Apparently, Ron Howard was really worried about having his guys on wires because it always just looks awkward, and it, like, if you watch them move, you can tell they're moving sort of from their center of mass because that's where the harness is connecting. They don't sort of tumble and do all the things that you do. And apparently his friend Steven Spielberg suggested that he get the KC-135, which is a jet plane, which it basically does like a roller coaster. You get in this jet plane and it's got a huge fuselage that's just empty. And they take the plane up and up and up and up and up, like a roller coaster, and then they just nosedive toward the ground. and you're inside this plane, and from an external reference, the plane is flying straight toward the ground, but from inside, compared to the walls, it's zero G, and you can just float around and bounce off the walls, and Lacey's having a panic attack.
Oh my God.
And so that's how they were able to simulate zero G. But here's the funny thing, and I can distract you by tapping into your actress for a moment. It only works for 23 seconds at a time. So all of those sequences, because otherwise you hit the ground.
Yes, because Earth comes up fast.
Exactly.
Oh my God.
So every scene throughout the film that you see of those three guys in the capsule where they're floating around and stuff is drifting around, that's not computer generated. That is actually like when they're drinking juice, the juice is actually flying up and getting on Kevin Bacon's face. But they're doing it 23 seconds at a time. There were no long takes. Everything had to be choppy.
Which is why they probably did it as the broadcast stuff, because then they don't have to have it be one, like, attempt to make it look like one take.
True, but I mean through the film. Like, to the very end, everything they do in the capsule, they had those kind of things.
So they filmed it all 23 seconds at a time.
I'm sure there were some scenes where nobody was floating, and so they were able to film it on the ground. But any time you see anybody floating around or zero G,
So my thought was as soon as liftoff happened, if anything goes wrong, I'm blaming Kevin Bacon.
Yep.
And I wasn't
she
totally
said it out
wrong.
Loud.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah.
It wasn't his fault. It seemed like it was his fault, but in the final analysis, in the thing that they did, they ultimately revealed that it was,
he was the rookie.
Yeah.
So I'm blaming
him. And therefore, in the name of hazing, we're going to blame Kevin Bacon because, you know, he's just connected to too many people.
Hey, right.
That's really that's the problem with Kevin Bacon. He's connected to too many people.
I will say that one of my other thoughts as soon as we saw Ed Harris was, man, this dude always gives me the creeps. And there's no way around it.
Yeah.
And you want to know what?
What?
By the end of this movie, he stopped giving me the creeps.
Hey.
I know.
You're not afraid of Ed Harris anymore.
It's amazing.
Right.
So that was, hey, if nothing else, Apollo 13 will help you get over your Ed Harris
phobia.
Issues.
Yeah.
Phobias. Yeah.
All right.
The other thing is this movie is just here to reinforce superstitions. It's
what do you mean?
The 13?
Oh, yes.
They hit it so hard.
Yeah.
And so I just had to get that in there.
Mm-hmm. I will say this. So we go up into space and we're floating around and they do this great scene where they're making a broadcast. And I have to say they do a really good job of making you sort of righteously indignant that the news broadcasts aren't even covering it anymore. At one point they say going to the moon is as exciting as going to Pittsburgh. And I was like, I'm sitting here, you know, 50 years later, and I'm still disagree with that shit.
Well, okay, hold on. You skipped a thing for me.
Okay.
So before they even get to the broadcast part, mm-hmm. there's a moment where there's an alarm that's going off, and it was just driving me bonkers. And Hank says, we've had our glitch for the mission.
Yeah.
And this dude, like, chuckles to himself, like, under his breath. It was very ominous, and I was like...
Yeah. Lacey, who doesn't know what's coming, is like, wait, did they not just have their glitch for the mission? What?
Like, I mean, I recognize drama has to happen. That is storytelling. Duh. But, like, the... he just had to scare me. That's
yep.
Just
didn't even mean to, but
yes,
I'm good at
the,
it.
The canceling, like all of the stations canceling their broadcast.
Yeah.
It was just like humiliating and depressing.
Sort of set them up as underdogs, which like how do you make a NASA astronaut going on his way to land on the moon an underdog?
Yeah.
But somehow they did. And now all of a sudden these guys are, you know, the ones to root for.
Mm-hmm.
I will say, as soon as the chaos breaks out, that movie did a surprisingly good job of balancing chaos without disorientation. Like, they were doing fast cuts and swiping across panels, and lights were turning on, and we were cutting down to mission control, and they were all freaking out. But I never felt like, what is happening, right? Like, I never got lost. I was following... Oh, this guy's over here doing this. This guy's checking a clipboard. They're all reporting things.
Mm-hmm.
I was tracking everything, and it leaned into that competence porn, like you were talking about, this sense that everybody in the room is really good at what they do. And so this is urgent, but it's not uncontrolled. It's just working the problem really fast.
One of the other things that I noticed with this movie is I never felt like the science was lost. And I think it's because they often cut to people who are explaining it really well.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't feel like we're going to have a lot to, I'm not going to have a lot to say about the real science of this because they do such a good job of explaining it as they're going that I was really impressed by that.
And that's actually the next note I have on my list is it's amazing how they made watching gauges and doing math riveting.
Yeah.
Like, even more than The Martian, which I usually hold up as sort of the gold standard of how to make science cool. This movie, you know, with The Martian, he's usually describing something he has just done. He's just explaining it to you. But this movie, you're just sitting there watching a dial.
Yeah.
Slowly drop, and then it stops dropping, and you're like...
or...
And then it keeps dropping, and you're like, ah! And it's so exciting.
Or you're watching Tom Hanks... freeze to death, and he's doing math, and he's erasing it, and you're like, no, don't erase
you
it.
You gotta figure it out, man.
You
like,
you gotta go faster.
Exactly. Like, you're literally just watching a guy do his homework, and it's so exciting.
And then he asks for everybody else on his, you know, math-leets team to double-check his work, and everyone's like, you're good to go, and I was like...
Great panning shot of the camera going down a counter as, like, six guys are all jotting down what he's saying and doing the math to... double and triple and quadruple and quintuple check his work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I had to, like, I kind of said this earlier, but I have to say it again. Watching the redundancy that happened there was phenomenal. When they were like, you know, normally it takes 3 hours to do...
to boot up the LEM.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you have 15 minutes to do it. There was something incredibly sexy about the idea that they were going to actually manage to do it because usually it takes 3 hours because there's so much redundancy, there's so much double checking, there's so much of all of that. But these are professionals who are going to actually move out of their comfort zone and manage to do it.
At the top of their game.
Right?
Just
I was just like...
awesome.
It floored me to watch. But it's on both sides of, you know, it's the guys up in space and it's also... the guys in Houston, Mission Control. And I was just like, dang, just watching all of them be there working as a team. Again, like, I just want more team films because it's so cool to watch people work together and figure things out and not agree on things, the yelling that they did at each other. Oh my God.
And just solving problems.
Yeah.
Like, there's so much, you know, so many movies, even movies that are ostensibly science movies, are actually about interpersonal conflict. Like the if you were to really boil this story down, this is a story about two guys who hate each other, or it's a story about a love triangle, or it's, you know, whatever. And there's, you know, when you live in Hollywood like we do, and when you work in Hollywood, you go to these writing classes and they talk about how everything is about human relationships. You have to base everything in human relationships. And that's one of those things that's mostly true.
Mm-hmm.
But I desperately want more movies like Apollo 13, like The Martian, like you know, there are a few stories out there that are about solving the problem.
Yeah.
And about these people coming together and working the problem. And obviously in individual scenes there are moments where two characters are butting heads, but the central through line of the story is here's a series of crises, fix them.
I will say with The Martian that they actually do it a little bit differently, because in The Martian everybody is like, there's one genius that can fix.
Yeah.
Like,
The Martian is a story of specialists.
Yeah. And yeah. I don't love that story as much in comparison to the story of a team who mm-hmm. the only way that they got through this is there are so many people that know all of the same information, but they're also tired. So it's all about like who remembers what mm-hmm. at any given moment.
And they do a great job of interweaving little personal details. You know, like everybody is a professional. Everybody's here. Mm-hmm. They're kind of all clones in the sense that they're all wearing the short sleeve button up shirt with the black tie. But this guy over here won't shut up about sort of covering his ass to make sure everybody knows that the engines weren't designed for this, because he's clearly a little bit of a coward when it comes to his career. And then over here is the doctor, who is just a little bit off, I guess, and doesn't get the fact that this is a crisis and they can't work exactly to the manual. And
yeah.
like all the different characters had their own little twist, and they were professionals.
Yes. And I think one of the awesome things that whenever we've gotten to have a larger team of like multiple devs, is the only way to have something work super smoothly mm-hmm. is when you have more than one idea as the input.
Yes.
You've got multiple heads working on the same problem. And that's what we got to see in this, and I love that.
You know, that's an interesting thing. I think, I never thought about this before, but I think you're right. I think I probably enjoyed Apollo 13 differently before you and I started Edgeworks. Because mm-hmm. before we started Edgeworks, this was a story about astronauts and, you know, all that kind of stuff. But since then, I have a feeling that I am subconsciously connecting with Ed Harris a little bit more.
Yeah.
Because we have a team, and we have had, you know, bugs that we have to immediately jump on and fix. And obviously, it's nothing on the scale of Apollo
13.
Yeah,
the 13. Stakes are a little bit lower.
Yeah. But
not that
is,
our publishers would agree with that.
Right, yeah. Hunter, if you're watching. But it's one of those things that, like you said, the sort of the camaraderie of problem solving mm-hmm. is something that has, I mean, when you start a company and you've got employees, that is your life. And that's a big part of this story. So, yeah.
One of my favorite moments was when they were all in the little room arguing down at Mission Control. And one of the guys says, we have to have this under, you know, we have to have everything running on 12. We've got 12 volts.
Or 12 amps.
12 amps, right.
Yeah,
yeah, no, that's what it is. And everyone is like, what? No. And he goes, no, I've been looking at this for an hour. And again, it comes back to, you have all these incredibly intelligent human beings, mm-hmm. but there's so much happening. Mm-hmm. You have to have so many eyes on the problem, and he has his eye on this problem.
Yeah.
And
as soon as he says, I've been working on this for an hour, everybody kind of shuts up.
Yeah.
Like, it's similar to something that I say about Star Trek a lot, which is, especially Star Trek The Next Generation, which is sort of my home base, there are so many opportunities where another show would have had characters kind of backbiting or like going behind each other's backs or talking to the captain being like, do you think he's really up for this, or, you know, anything like that. But in Star Trek, everybody kind of respects everybody else's professionalism. And even if this episode is about somebody screwing up, it's not held against them forever.
Yeah.
And in the same way in this movie, like, there is one moment where the astronauts kind of start to doubt that maybe Mission Control might not have their back. But for the most part, when the expert says, I've done the math, Ed Harris nods and goes, okay, what do we do next? And there's no backbiting or any of that kind of stuff.
Yeah. It was super awesome. And going back to the flight surgeon, I just have to call this out real quick, you guys. We love Christian Clemson.
Yes.
He is the one who plays Dr. Chuck. But he was also on Boston Legal.
Yes.
And he is an incredible actor. This guy is phenomenal, and I could watch him all day. But his voice, I could pick it out, like as soon as I heard the voice, I knew it was him, and I could listen to that voice all day, every day.
You know,
he's got a beautiful voice.
People use the phrase or use the term underrated a lot. And, you know, people say things like, oh, Star Wars is so underrated. And, you know, no, it's not. Like, Star Wars is popular and it deserves to be popular. Everybody knows how popular it is. He is one actor who I genuinely think is underrated. That guy is not doing as much as he deserves to be doing.
We have a Pence fly.
We do.
Give us a second. All right.
All right. yes, but that guy is awesome, and yeah.
Yeah, he's, so again, his name is Christian Clemson. Go look him up on IMDb and then watch everything he's ever done, and then tell me that you agree with me, because if you don't agree with me, we're going to fight, and I'm going to win.
You're wrong.
Yeah, okay. Just so we've made that very clear.
Speaking of characters that are awesome and hilarious and kind of steal the spotlight for a minute, let's talk about the grandma.
Grandma's so great.
That actress has played the grandma in basically everything you've ever seen. And she's so good at being kind of dotty and kind of, you know, just out of touch little old lady. And then one moment in this movie, she has this moment of clarity that is so badass. And I just love that this little old lady who is so typecast gets to have her one kind of hero moment.
I wrote, okay, so the quote is, if they could get a washing machine to fly, my Jimmy could land it.
And that's,
I just really feel like everybody needs a mom or a dad to be that supportive. Just to believe in you. Do you know how far we would probably be in this world if everybody
as
had
a society
parents who were like that lady? Oh my gosh. I loved that.
And on a similar note, we have a moment that is an absolute knife to the heart, which is early in the film, Tom Hanks is talking to his little boy who is nervous about the flight and specifically nervous about Apollo 1, the astronauts who burned to death. And Tom Hanks walks him through, you know, a whole bunch of stuff had to go wrong. And, you know, we fixed that stuff. And the example that he uses is the door or the hatch that they couldn't get open. And so they couldn't get out. And then when things start going wrong, the mom comes in and she very specifically says, a bunch of things went wrong with your daddy's spaceship. And this little boy just looks at her and says, was it the door? And
God,
it's
it was
just so good.
It's I immediately started crying.
Yeah.
And I'm...
that. There are a lot of kids that age who could not have delivered that line that well. Like, there are a lot of bad child actors out there, and that kid is not one of them.
Yeah, it was excellent.
Yeah.
There was another moment where it's... Paxton's family. I don't remember their names. But, you know, his wife is pregnant and they're sitting with their family. And it's before they know, like, how this all ends. And the little one of the boys who plays one of her kids, he, as a little actor, obviously forgot where he was and what he was supposed to be doing. Because they're all gathered around the TV listening to just like this awful news. And he turns and looks at the woman playing the mom and smiles, this big, bright smile. And the way she reacts to him was just like heartbreaking because she still stays in it.
Yeah.
And she gives him a reassuring smile, but you can see in her eyes, that's not at all how she feels. And I was just like, I don't know. It just like kind of took my breath away because that wasn't the scene or that wasn't the...
That was clearly an organic moment.
Yeah, they would not have meant for that take to happen, and it totally just did, and it worked, and I love it. So good. Going back to that voice, that calm voice that they use, Hanks does such a good job of masking in this movie, and that's a term that gets thrown around by actors all the time, which is like when you've got this big feeling over here, and you're pretending you don't, you've got this mask on. It's the pot that's about to boil over, and you're trying to keep it under wraps. And his ability to go from totally panicked to his calm voice.
Yeah.
Well, he just turned on a dime, and I was like, oh my God.
Yeah, there's one scene where they're all yelling at each other, and there's this term, are we on Vox, which means just sort of an open mic. Can Mission Control hear everything we're saying? They're all yelling at each other, and all of a sudden they get a broadcast from Mission Control, and he says, are we on Vox? And it turns out they're not, and he reaches down, presses a button, and goes, yeah, Mission Control, we're reading you. And it's just this absolute pivot on a dime from high energy, stressed out, yelling at each other to super professional lockdown.
Mm-hmm.
So good.
I loved it. Yeah. I loved it. I have to say that when they finally get a hold of Sinise, and get him out of bed and bring him to Mission Control is like one of my favorite things. I was like, oh, he's gonna save the day.
Right?
And I loved watching him save the day. If they don't sleep, I don't sleep. Like the whole, I don't know. It was just so in it. And I love that towards the end, you see the thing. So you see Tom Hanks's character. There's an old interview of when has he felt fear? And he was lost over the sea near Japan, and everything was going wrong, and his lights went out in his cockpit. Mm-hmm. And because of that, he was able to see the bioluminescence in the water, which allowed him to land on the ship, the aircraft carrier. And he said, you never know what it's going to be that gets you home.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the measles.
Mm-hmm.
It's purely the measles because, like, God bless Kevin Bacon, but he wasn't going to be the guy who would have gotten them all home.
Figured that out.
Yeah. He would. The and fact, Sinise wouldn't have been able to do that up in space.
Right.
He wouldn't have been able to do that work.
That's a good point. I hadn't thought about that. Measles saves the day.
Yeah, exactly. So it's essentially measles are the lights going out, and Sinise becomes the bioluminescence. And I was just like, oh, that was powerful, and I didn't need that in my life. I did, but like, it gets me for clicked.
You don't like strong emotions.
I do. I like strong emotions, just not when I don't want them.
I will say we would be remiss if we went through this entire episode without talking about the greatest homage to Apollo 13 that has ever been done, which is an episode of Community called Basic Rocket Science. And in that episode, Abed plays the Gary Sinise role and does it absolutely perfectly. And apparently there are a ton of shots in that episode that mirror shots from the movie. They go deep dive into recreating Apollo 13, specific mannerisms and things.
I love Community.
So, yeah.
Abed was such a great character, my goodness.
Yes, indeed.
We're kind of jumping all over the place, and I think that's a lot my fault. But
I don't actually have anything, any notes until the ending, and then a few sort of after things. So
take us
through the second act.
Well, I don't really. I'm going to continue being all over the place because I don't know where we are in the story. But I'm just going to point out a couple of things that I loved. First of all, I love the little medical mutiny.
Yes.
And like, I guess really mutiny is against the captain, and the captain is Tom Hanks and he starts it. So I don't know that you'd actually call it mutiny, but whatever it is, I loved it. Yeah. It made me really happy. And that corridor scene where they're having to figure out how to get into position to enter the atmosphere. So they're too shallow and they need to manually put themselves in a place where they can come in a little bit at a sharper angle, but not too sharp. And the newscasters use the if Earth is the basketball and the moon is the softball, and the area, the corridor that they have
is thinner than a piece of paper.
Yeah, I was just like, again, it comes back to the real science. They did, while to me, I would have loved to have seen more of it.
Mm-hmm.
What we did see was so well done that I was still happy with it.
And, you know, one of the things that's nice about using real science is that oftentimes using something real prevents you from going too far in either direction. Because I feel like if this was a fictional movie that somebody was writing, they would have been really tempted to either make the necessary thing that they had to do so ludicrously impossible that there's like a 0.001% chance that they could pull this off, and then they do. Or they would have hedged their bets, and they would have been like, I mean, you know, here's a baseball, here's a softball, and the area that they have to get into is like this big, you know? Okay. And it's not something that seems totally impossible because we need it to be believable. But the fact that this is real means that you don't have to convince people it's believable. It actually happened.
Yeah.
And you can just lean into that, and it sort of veers you away from some of the more cartoony options that a writer could have taken.
Mm-hmm. And one of the other real science things is they go to the weight. They finally figure out why all of their calculations are off, and it's because they expected to have a couple hundred pounds of moon rocks.
Yeah, there's this sort of running thread throughout the second half of the movie that they keep veering a little bit off course, and they can't tell why do they keep coming in shallow, and oh, it's because we were supposed to have all these moon rocks.
Mm-hmm.
And so they end up having to get ballast for the last
So they pull, they pull a bunch of stuff off of the LEM, right,
into the command module to just help weigh it down a little more.
And I love that they gave that to us. They didn't go into as much detail, and you know, they didn't spell it out too much, but we got a little taste of that, which I thought was really nice, because I had forgotten that they were having calculation problems. There's so much going wrong because you know that what they have a quadruple failure
at which least
is, well, I mean, that's what they say at the top of the top is that there's a quadruple failure. But two of the other things that I just have to say is Tom Hanks just holds our hearts in his hand. He like just mushes them all together, and he holds them and he plays with our heartstrings. And I, for one, never gave him permission to do that. but he does it all the time without reservation. And I would like to admonish him in person while I hug him and cry. I love him. I'm just, is that, I don't know, is that clear enough?
Yeah.
I love him. Okay.
in a very angry way.
Angry way. Yes. Okay. Last thing, before I will let you speak too.
No, go for it.
That little moment where they are gathering to watch the reentry, and his wife is taking to the audience. We have no idea who these two men are, but she's telling them, you need to distract his mom while they're talking about the likelihood of the crew living. And it turns out to be Armstrong and Aldrin. and the lady says, are you boys in the space program too? Oh my God.
And they both kind of, they have this like little hesitation as they kind of look at each other. Like, is she for real?
Yeah. And she is for real.
Yes.
which I just like, I don't know if that happened in real life, but I really hope it did. Because that's amazing.
Which brings us to heading in for the final landing. Couldn't let it be too easy because they've gotten off so easy this whole time. You're heading into a typhoon because
the freaking eye of the storm.
Yeah.
Oh my
incredible
God.
Shot as this ship flies toward the earth and there's this swirling vortex like right below them with lightning flashes. Incredible.
If one thing can go wrong, apparently everything can go wrong.
Exactly.
For them.
We're going to be talking about Gravity next week, and Gravity, I think, is one of these movies that can be retitled.
I forgot we were watching the movie, and I was like, excuse me, what?
Yeah.
We're just talking about straight Gravity?
Gravity, I've always joked, should be retitled The Story of a Woman Who Just Can't Catch a Break. And that is very much in the spirit of Apollo 13, the guys who could not catch a break.
I don't remember much about it except for the...
Oh, you're going to have a grand old time.
I'm not.
You're not.
And
not even a little bit.
Mostly, I just remember her in the fetal position in front of that weird light, and I was just like, all right.
Yeah. Oh, no. You're going to be so mad by the end of this movie.
I know. I remember feeling that way before, so.
And in that same spirit, as they're coming down, it starts kind of raining in their faces. There's a shot of the dew that has been gathering on the console.
But before we get there, can I say I was so glad when there was finally a body heat hug?
Yes.
I had been waiting for that because these men are freezing and they're not touching each other. And like, I know they've got a lot to do.
Yeah.
But one of them is very sick.
Yes.
So I was pleasantly surprised when it happened because I was desperate for it to happen. But I had kind of gotten to a point of this is a man's man sort of world and they're not going to touch. And I was just like, but Tom Hanks doesn't live in that world very well. So I was just, it was a relief. I needed to put that out there.
Yes, indeed. So they re-enter, and as with any ship entering the atmosphere, there's always a period of communications blackout where the radio signals can't get through the ionization happening around the ship. And they say it's going to be between 3 and 4 minutes. It's generally 3, and the countdown starts happening, and they get to 3 minutes, and there's nothing. And it just keeps going. They end up hitting 3.5. They end up hitting 4, and it's just like this slow twisting of tension as you think maybe they actually didn't make it. And then they finally do. And it's such a relief, and everybody's cheering. And I just need to read you this quote from Jim Lovell talking about that moment and why they, because that's not Hollywood. That actually happened. There was this really long period where they didn't respond, and they could not, and everybody thought they were dead. This is a quote from Jim Lovell. He says, we were working and watching the controls during that time. Because we came in shallow, it took us longer to come through the atmosphere where we had ionization. And the other thing was we were just slow in responding.
Oh.
The entire world was waiting with bated breath to see if these guys were alive, and apparently they just like didn't pick up the phone for a while.
Oh my God. If I was his wife, I would have lost my mind when he got home. If when I heard that quote, yeah, I would have been like, you're a dead man.
Yeah.
You are a dead man. But yeah, the moment that there is that re-entry and it's literally raining on them.
Yes.
Like, that is just...
just adding insult to injury.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, what? It's raining on them, but outside of the capsule, it's like 3,000 to 4,000 degrees, I think is what they said.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah,
some number of thousands of degrees, and they're getting
rained on. Getting rained on, and I was just like, oh my God. Because, I mean, yeah, we've been warned about it, so I love that they kept that detail. It was really, I liked that.
Another little cameo right here at the end. The captain of the USS Iwo Jima, which is the ship that picks them up, the captain is played by Jim Lovell.
Oh, really?
Yep.
I like that.
Yeah.
Nice. It was funny. I was not expecting a shot of someone in all of their scuba gear like peering in the window. It was, I don't know, there was something about it that was just really funny. I feel like in the course of, you know, there are window images now in my head. And so I have the Titanic and I have an astronaut burning, and now I have a
goofy scuba guy being like, are you guys okay?
You just got in from space. Yeah. I'm here to help you.
Hey, welcome back. there's, you know, it's funny. These days, you know, we're saturated with these images of SpaceX with these rockets that come down and like land so gently on their floating platforms. And even before that, we had the space shuttle, which comes down like an airplane and lands very majestically on a runway. And you sort of forget that in the early days of space travel, it was a little bit goofy getting back to Earth. Like you were in a little pod that just kind of falls into the ocean, and then they have to go find you like wherever you landed in the ocean, and you just sit in your pod until some scuba guy comes up and like knocks on the door and helps you out.
There was a part of me that was like, we scuba dive.
Yes.
And I've always been a little, not a lot, but a little interested in doing rescue diving.
Mm.
And there was a part of me that's like, I want to be that person. Can we go back to this era and I can just be the scuba diver that's like, hey, I'm going to help you get home.
Yeah.
I don't know why, but that sounds awesome.
There's a moment where the helicopter is hovering overhead and a couple of scuba guys step out. And when you go scuba diving, whenever you first get into the water, they always tell you to sort of step onto the side of the boat, and you either fall backwards into the water or they tell you to take this really big step to just sort of stride out and then let yourself fall into the water. And they were doing that. They were stepping out, but from a helicopter. And so they fall like, you know, 25 feet and then go into the water. And I was like, oh, that seems kind of like fun. Can I do that? Like, that's,
except for
go scuba diving
in
Catalina Island, but from a helicopter.
When we were in New Zealand, Is that where we were? I think it was when we were in New Zealand and we were canyoning. I was the one who was like, oh my God, I want to jump off that thing. Can we jump off that thing? And they're like, yeah, go jump off that thing. And you were like, I don't want to do that.
It helps when it's the ocean. There's no functional bottom to that. When you're jumping off a really high, which by the way was about twice as tall as the helicopter that guy stepped out of. And then it's like a little, you know, pond. The water was about 3 inches.
I just want to put it out there that in this family, I am not the chicken.
Can confirm.
I wasn't expecting that. I mean, it's true, but I wasn't expecting you to say that. Okay. Oh, I loved all of the reaction shots when everybody learns that, hey, they made it. And I have to tell you, I was really surprised by a couple of them.
Mm-hmm.
Ed Harris, I love how he sits and everybody else stands.
Yes, everybody rises and he drops.
Yeah, and I was like, oh, that's like that makes total sense. And they came back to him later, and he was tearing up. And I was like, man, Ed Harris, like, I love you. I'll give you a hug, which is not where I started at the top of this movie.
That was a whole journey you went on with Ed Harris.
And I was really concerned about the oldest Lovell boy.
Yeah, the oldest son.
Because he's...
Who's only introduced at the 11th hour. Do we see him in the first act?
I mean, I think we see him when the moon landing happens. But
do we? I was trying to remember.
No, because it's not that age, right?
I think it's only like a year later. Like, he wouldn't have been a little kid at that time. It's only a year or two.
Then maybe we didn't. But he's at, what, a military academy or something?
Yeah, he's at a military academy.
And there was a part of me that's like, they're all watching this. And this is the 60s, maybe the 70s. And
yeah, so this is April 11th, 1970.
Okay.
So it's a few months, like less than a year after.
Okay, so they're watching this. He's surrounded by his male peers. Is he going to be allowed to like be relieved? Is he going to be allowed to cry? Because like, I really felt like I was going to have to say something about masculinity of that time that might still be a thing today. But I didn't have to because Ed Harris cried.
Yeah.
And so there was this thing where like all of the boys got really excited for him and we didn't see him cry, but
he was mostly just stunned.
He was just like in shock, it's still totally acceptable. You don't have to cry, but there was a part of me that was like, man, if none of these men cry, I'm going to have to call toxic masculinity because you got to show your emotions.
Yeah.
And this
get
is
some,
just so
get some
much
manly
stress
tears.
Well,
in
yeah, because I mean that amount of stress is you're going to have a bodily reaction and you just kind of have to.
Yeah.
So, I was glad to see it somewhere. I was really concerned that we weren't going to see the oldest son's reaction because they don't show it for the longest time.
Yeah.
And I was mostly interested in his as a like teenager at a military school.
Mm-hmm.
I've
got a few other notes just sort of in terms of general scientific stuff. Unless you want to say anything else about the landing.
No.
So I did some research on scientific accuracy in Apollo 13 because that's our thing here on The Synthesis. And learned some interesting stuff. So apparently NASA was very helpful during all this, and they offered the use of many of their facilities. They offered Ron Howard to let Ron Howard film in the actual mission control.
Ooh.
And he turned them down. They recreated mission control in a set so that they could perfectly control everything. But apparently they did such a good job that their consultants kept getting lost because the room was perfect, but obviously outside the room, it was a studio. And so there was one particular way to leave, but it was the other way from where you leave actual mission control. The elevator was over here and the exit from the set was over here. And the consultants were they bought into this thing so much that they kept getting lost because they kept heading for the elevator for mission control.
Oh, that's neat.
And then they also, the headsets that all the extras use in mission control, all of their consoles were actually networked. So that as all of those actors, the supporting characters and the extras, were sort of shouting over each other trying to solve problems, they were actually talking to each other. They could carry on conversations, sending information back and forth. They weren't all just kind of saying things to themselves actorly.
Interesting. Interesting.
Which, yeah, was another interesting choice. The spacesuits that they wore were apparently perfect. They were spacesuits. They were in every single regard. There were no compromises made to the point where they were even airtight. And when the astronauts have their helmets on in this movie, they also have air hoses connecting them because otherwise they would suffocate. Like, these are actual spacesuits, and they had to have their air pumped in.
Oh, fascinating.
Yeah. Walter Cronkite, very famous news personality from that era, does a number of broadcasts. Some of those were archival footage from the time of Apollo 13. But apparently Walter Cronkite actually re-recorded some news broadcasts for this film because they needed him to say something sort of concisely for the film, because in the actual broadcast, he sort of spread it out over several minutes. And he got the script and then rewrote it in his own voice so that it would sound like a real Walter Cronkite broadcast.
I love that.
Very interesting. And then the last little bit of filmmaking that I have is one of the most famous lines from Apollo 13. You'll see it on every time somebody references this. They'll show this little bit of B-roll. It's in every trailer, everything. It's Ed Harris walking with purpose through a room full of professionals, and he says, "Failure is not an option." And it's become this line that is very heavily associated with the Apollo 13 crisis. Apparently, he never actually said that. The character, that's not a thing that was said during during Apollo 13, the crisis. But the writers were talking to several of their consultants who had been there, including a person named Jerry Bostick, who they asked him, "Did you guys ever just like panic? Did you just freeze with how much stress there was?" And his response was, "No, when bad things happened, we just calmly laid out the options, and failure was not one of them. We never panicked, and we never gave up on finding a solution." And apparently the writers left that meeting, got in the car, and one of them, as soon as the doors closed, he just started screaming, "Failure is not an option. That's the line. That's going to be the line that people remember from this movie. We just need to figure out who says it." And they ended up giving it to Ed Harris, and he was exactly right.
I can't believe that you haven't brought up the square peg in a round hole.
That is one of my very favorite. Before we get to that, I've got one other line, which is, "Houston, we have a problem," which has gone down alongside "Luke, I am your father," and "Play it again, Sam," as incredibly iconic lines from Hollywood, which never happened. All three of those lines, it's almost right. In actual history, they said, "Houston, we've had a problem," and then they go on to describe it. But "Houston, we have a problem" is...
Just changed tenses.
A little bit, yeah.
It's close enough.
That being said, Lacey does bring up a good point, which is probably my favorite moment from this movie, which is getting a square peg into a round hole. The team at Mission Control is presented with a problem because CO2 is building up in the LEM, and the air filters for the LEM are not designed to support this many people, but the air filters from the command module don't fit. They're two different shapes. And so they dump out a bunch of stuff on the table and they say, "This is everything they've got up there. We need to figure out how to use this stuff to get this filter into a hole that fits this." And it's a very famous moment. And I just love it because it's so sort of ground level. Like, they're literally playing with blocks. They're just doing sort of kindergarten level stuff, but lives depend on it.
Yeah, and I loved that scene, and I'm definitely one of those people who would have liked to have seen it play out a little bit more. And not like the whole thing. I didn't need to be for it to be like 30 minutes or anything like that. But he dumps out the stuff that they have available to them, and then he's like, "All right, we have to do this." And then everyone just grabs for it, and I'm like, Wait, who's project managing this?
Yeah, exactly.
No,
we
don't
get organized.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like, if you just start grabbing things, who's going to know what you have?
Yeah.
And I wanted to see it play out. Like, I wanted to see...
Yeah, that is one scene that I wish had been done more.
Yeah, because it's cool to see geniuses attack a problem that you can watch. Because, like, most of us aren't going to be able to follow a math problem. But this is something that's so physical that we could have seen how their minds work. And I get that it's not a problem that
Yeah, you got to keep the story moving.
Yeah, like, yeah. And I hear that, but I would have liked it.
It is also, you know, as we've talked about, The Martian is, we're big fans, and you can clearly see the influence of Apollo 13 on the concept of The Martian. There's a clear lineage there. And I was reading reviews recently, and somebody described The Martian as being the perfect movie for people who wish that air filter scene from Apollo 13 had been the whole film. Which I feel like the reviewer meant it as kind of a dig at nerds, but I read it and I was like, yeah, that.
Yes,
that's
please.
Me. I'm one of those people.
Like, I want to see scientists and MacGyver things.
Exactly. Because what could be cooler than MacGyver and real?
Yeah. Like, yeah. So I think overall.
Yeah.
Oh, wait, are you done?
Well, I've got one little sort of addendum, a little epilogue on the story of Apollo 13, which is sort of a good news, bad news situation. So after Apollo 13 was so scary, the Apollo program kind of got wrapped up. And that is one of the reasons we never went to Mars, is Apollo 13. Is after the Apollo 13 crisis, President Nixon and then those who followed decided that space travel was really scary and they didn't want a disaster hanging around their necks. And so they decided instead of continuing to push the frontier, continuing to try dangerous new things and go out into the unknown, what they would do is perfect this. And they came up with the space shuttle. And that's why the space shuttle program happened, was it was their attempt to get near-Earth travel perfected. And so we're going to make basically like a space plane that we can reuse over and over, and it'll be able to land on its own, and it'll have all these things. And so NASA put all of its effort into the space shuttle and near-Earth orbit operations like satellites and the International Space Station, and we retreated from the frontier. So that is sort of the...
I don't like that. Yeah. Humans are not good at retreat. And
I know.
I don't like that our leaders are cowards.
And
cowards.
So it's good that we are now living in an age when, you know, things like SpaceX and even NASA are starting to pick up the baton again and start moving forward.
Yes, well, I just want it to be NASA, so...
Yes, but that would be nice.
That's a whole other topic, yeah. So we don't need to end on that note. Let's
yeah.
Also...
Final thoughts?
Final thought. I think it is... devastating that Gary Sinise's character didn't get his dream, but I think it is even more devastating, heartbreaking to be that close. You can see it.
Yes.
You can. It's right there.
Yeah,
but
it must have been just a knife in the gut for those three guys flying past the moon and just not.
I don't know. Like that, I just kind of keep coming back to that thought of dreams should not. You shouldn't have to see them without touching them. It's just, it's too much for my actor heart, because being an actor has far, far too much has to do with hope than and luck than anything else. So, my actor heart didn't handle that very well. Incredible movie.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
Fantastic movie. Apollo 13, obviously hailed as one of the great space movies of all time. Just absolute masterpiece. And,
I think...
Just A+ on the scientific accuracy score. This is sort of the thing to beat. This is the standard by which things get judged.
I will say, accuracy, yes. A- for how much science is in it.
Fair enough.
I would have liked to have seen it ratcheted up a notch.
Yeah. All right.
So.
Fair enough.
Yeah. All right, well, then...
I think that's episode one of The Synthesis.
Ooh!
Yeah.
Look at us.
That was fun.
We're amazing.
Thank you to everybody who's been watching and who will be watching in the future. This has been a fun little experiment, and unless we were completely in the dark, I don't think anything went terribly wrong. Who knows? Maybe we'll end this thing and then realize that we've been broadcasting color bars this whole time.
Our producer will let us know.
Yeah.
So the next episode, we will have watched Gravity. So if you want to kind of...
Follow along,
yep. I would suggest... watching it.
Yep. Same bat time, same bat channel, which is 5:30 Pacific time on Thursday. You're going to be watching Gravity and talking about that. And you'll get to see Lacey have a slow panic attack, which is going to be fun.
So much fun. I am so excited to show that side of myself to you guys.
Awesome. All right.
Bye, guys.
Thanks for watching. Have a good one.